Good afternoon and welcome. If you're watching from afar, welcome to a packed St. Mary's Perivale, or fairly packed, very keen audience, despite the restrictions. We're all wearing masks, except me. I can't talk at the same time, but I'll be putting it on shortly afterwards. And it's very nice having you. This is our penultimate concert before Christmas. We just got one more with Francis and Indira Greer on Friday evening. But today, as always on Tuesday, we have a solo piano recital, and it gives me huge pleasure to welcome back one of our most popular and best pianists, a close friend who's been playing in these concerts for 15 years and gets better and better, Ashley Fripp. So can we have a big round of applause?
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's such a great pleasure to be here. I think it's been more than 2 years since I've played here with an audience, so that's obviously very special for me as well. I'm going to be playing two rather large pieces, the first of which is a Mozart sonata. Interestingly, so out of about 600 pieces, Mozart only wrote 30 in the minor key, so they were reserved for quite tumultuous moods. And although there's no correspondence about this particular sonata, scholars have dated it to 1778 based on the manuscript paper which he bought in Paris at the time that he was nursing his mother. So she was dying at the time, and I think this particular sonata is full of incredible torment, and it's a very, very tortured sonata. The last movement in particular, the left hand almost never plays on the downbeat, and so it's got this incredibly restless, rather breathless quality to it. So it's an absolutely extraordinary sonata. Hugh and I were talking about how Mozart is sort of easy for 10-year-olds but impossible for adults. It's very exposed, but it's such wonderful, wonderful dramatic music, so I hope that you'll enjoy it. Thank you. sort of breathe a sigh of relief now. And so I thought it would be particularly interesting to program these two sonatas together because sort of existential crisis forms an important, I think, inspiration behind the two works. Obviously, I've talked about how you know, Mozart wrote this at the time that his mother was dying. And this final Schubert sonata, the very last sonata he wrote just 2 months before he died, of course, was written at a time when he would have been very well aware of his fate. And I think what's so unusual about this particular sonata is it's his longest, and it's got the most... it's got more silence in it than any of the other Schubert sonatas. And there's an amazing sense that, despite, he knew that he really had just weeks left, there's this sense of this incredible sort of cosmos ahead of him and... all the time in the world. And I think what's also, hopefully you'll pick up, particularly during the first movement, is that a lot of the main melodies and themes that get developed later on, they actually appear almost as accompanimental figures. And there's a real sense of coming of age about this sonata, that sort of wisdom and sense only comes in hindsight. I suppose it's like the Danish philosopher Kierkegaard said, life can only be understood forwards, can only be lived forwards but understood backwards. And I really think that there's an incredible sense of that in this sonata. The second movement is perhaps one of the most desolate of all slow movements that Schubert wrote. And I think it's, especially when it goes into the major key, like with Brendel, it says that, when Schubert writes in the major, it's even more tragic than in the minor. Hugh and I, again, we were talking about this sonata before you all arrived, and some people, perhaps even Andras Schiff, think that perhaps Schubert lost inspiration a little bit with the third and fourth movement, but I absolutely don't think that's true at all. The scherzo and trio, there's a real sense of the afterlife and hope, and the type of accompanimental figures that he uses are quite apparent in a lot of the songs that he wrote about water and the sea, and there's a real sense of eternal life that's obviously associated with that, that sense of water constantly flowing. And the last movement is sort of typical, sort of almost Hungarian dance in many ways, and it just makes a fantastic conclusion to the sonata. So hope that you'll enjoy it. It's quite a huge piece. It's almost 40 minutes, so I'll get cracking.
Thank you.
I don't know. Chopin waltz, maybe, something, yeah.
Well, that was simply wonderful piano playing, absolutely glorious. I don't know what to say for once. Absolutely beautiful sound all afternoon, and the way he put over that big structure of the Schubert with ravishing different colours and intellectual understanding of it all, and made it all so beautiful. Quite moving, very moving. Absolutely wonderful pianist. He must have done about 25 recitals here, if not more, over the years. So he gets better and better, and we'll get him back. Thank you very much, everyone, for watching, if you've been watching from afar. And if you'd like to show your appreciation in a tangible form, please do so. Go to our donate page on PayPal and donate something to keep the show on the road. You're doing a grand job, but keep the show going. And have a very good Christmas. There's one more concert, the Greers, Indira and Francis Greer, on Friday night at 7:30, our first evening concert for about 20 months. And then we have a carol concert on Sunday afternoon, then we pack up for a fortnight, then kick off in the new year. And I think we're streaming more concerts than any other venue. And a terrific lineup of musicians stretching right through to the summer, in fact, to the autumn. So Do keep watching. Thank you very much for being with us, and a very good afternoon to you.